morning, Fellowship of Faith. I'm Tina Gaddini.
And I'm Justin Johnson. And we're back as a team again. Woo! So how was your week off?
It was weekend.
Weekend off.
It was fantastic.
Where'd you go?
So I visited my family in Indiana.
That's right. I didn't know that.
And it's been a couple years.
Really?
I feel bad about it.
But makes sense.
Like, I met my nephew, who was almost two, for
That's
the first time.
Exciting.
Oh, I felt bad that I did it.
Well,
life just goes so fast.
Well, it's COVID too. You don't want to cross just in case.
Yep.
But that's exciting. Good.
Yeah.
Good.
It was really
to
good.
See your family.
And I got to tell you, guys, I miss you a lot. So we went out on Sunday to another church.
Okay.
Okay. When I go home to visit, it's hard to find a church that I like because I'm not going to the church that I grew up in. It's just difficult.
Yep,
it's weird.
I understand.
And so we went to this. It was a community church in Fort Wayne, Indiana. And I'm just like, okay, I'm going with my family. That's fine. And I walk in there. I'm like, oh. And I just kind of stood in the back. And it's like the music was loud. I mean, and it's like, if I moved, I could come here.
Oh, look at that.
It was really good. I was like standing in the back of the sanctuary. I'm like, because my friend,
No,
my friend's husband does security there. And so they don't normally sit in the sanctuary. They sit in like the community room.
So big church then.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. And so they normally sit in the community room because he can kind of be there with them.
Makes sense.
In the sanctuary, he's not.
Right.
I'm like, but as the wife of a pastor, whenever we go to other churches, you always check them out. You always like, where's the tech booth? Where's this? How do they do this? How do they run the service? And so it's never like just go to worship. It's kind of steal ideas. And so that's what I was doing. And I stood in the back and like, oh, I don't want to go to the community room. I want to stay here. Like, this is like connecting with me. It was really cool. So I do the whole service. And then afterwards, I'm like, so my friends came and sat with me. And I'm like, so what did you guys think of the service? What did you think of the message? What do you have? How is the music? And then I like pretended to hand a microphone to them. And they're like, wait, what are you doing?
What's going
like,
on here? You don't understand. You don't get it. What we do over here. Well,
so it was good.
We missed
Matt,
you.
Matt did a fantastic job.
Yes, he did.
Thank you, Matt.
We're filling in on short notice. I just literally told him 15 minutes before we start, or before 9 o'clock started, like, hey, do you want to do the show with me? Sure.
And
here we are. I like that he decided to do dad jokes, Bible dad
that
jokes.
That was fantastic.
I thought it was
that
very
was fantastic.
Funny.
Fantastic. And I was listening to, because I watched.
Right, of course.
And, you know, Dave introduced all of the dinner tables.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, I can't believe I'm missing this, because I would tell my online people, like, it doesn't matter where you are, you set up a dinner table.
Yeah.
And I'm like, and they're not going to say it. And I'm just like, oh, I can't believe I missed that. And then Matt.
Mm-hmm.
Matt's
coming
like,
through.
Hey, guys. Like, yes. Yes.
See?
It's not just us. It is our whole culture.
Exactly.
And I love
We're
that.
A big community.
Love
so.
That. So, as much as I enjoyed my last weekend experience, it is so good to be back.
Well, we're happy to have you back.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Dynamic duo back again. Guys, so please let us know that you're worshiping with us today by texting here to 855-465-2720. Like and subscribe, whatever platform you are watching / listening to us on.
Oh, and share. Oh, and
share.
Share.
And share. And share. See, Tina's about to share right now.
Easy peasy.
Gotta spread the word to all your friends on Facebook or wherever. Can you? Probably ask this question a bunch of times. Can you share stuff on Spotify? I'm not on Spotify, so I don't really know.
Spotify? No.
No, I didn't think so.
I don't know.
Because I think that's where our services go, right? At the end, I don't know.
I think Andy
Rambling
posts
now.
Them there.
Yeah, but you can't like share it.
Right.
You don't have, like a page.
Oh, there's you and me.
Uh huh. See.
Hey, me and Justin.
And she's going
to share.
Right.
Post.
Also, if we could be praying for you in whatever way possible, you can also text prayer to 855-465-2720. That will go directly to one of our elders, and we will reach out to you in person to pray with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Today is a fun Sunday, one of my favorites.
Yes.
It is questions you never thought you could ask in church live. Wednesdays are live, too, but it's not in person.
Now this is in person and live. A nice summer thing we do, which seems to be we've done in the past couple
of
years.
It really speaks. It speaks to our culture.
Yes,
you know,
it does.
We're not afraid of questions. Ask your questions.
No, and that's what I like about this. Like, if you have any burning questions that you want asked, text it in, and we'll if we doesn't get to them today.
We got a lot in our culture going on right
exactly,
now.
Exactly,
bring in some good questions.
A lot. So.
All right.
Text it in. If we don't get it to today, we'll do it next week.
They'll post the text in number.
Yep, the number will be on the screen.
Yeah.
So go ahead and do that.
All right. We'll see you guys at the end.
Enjoy.
good morning, everyone. Welcome to Fellowship of Faith. Since some of you are standing, some of you are not, why don't we all stand up and let's greet each other and say hello.
So stamp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. And Christ is on the rock. I stand on the ground and sink it down. So stamp your feet and clap your hands.
Guys, so good to see you this morning. Why don't you go ahead and grab a seat. My name is David Gedini, pastor here on staff at Fellowship of Faith. Just want to extend a big thank you to every single one of you who chose to take time out of a Sunday morning to come here in person or to tune in with us on live this morning. Thanks for carving out some time for God. I think it's going to matter. I think it's going to make a difference. I think it'll be significant. I think it's what God wants, and I think it honors Him. Way to go in that, and hopefully today we grow closer together, we learn more about Him, and we discover what it means to be a body of Christ. That's our dream here for you today, and our dream here as a church. Here at FOF, we never want to be a sea of nameless faces. We don't think church should be like a restaurant where we just kind of come and go and consume from a similar menu of items, but rather that we're called to be words that the Bible will use, like a community, like a family, like a human body all integrally working and connected with one another. We think that honors God. We think that's what God wants. And if you wouldn't mind, do just a little something this morning to help that connectivity happen. There's a number that's going to pop up on the screen in just a moment, 855-465-2720. Just text the word here. Just make a base touch with us here this morning, whether online or here in person, just the word here. If you're new with us today, we'd especially ask that you do this. We're not going to spam you. We're not going to kind of put you on mailing lists that are never going to end or something like that, but I would love to reach out and just introduce myself and say hello and maybe ask if I could be praying for you in some kind of way. And if you're here in person, I'd love to meet you in person as well. Come grab me after the service. I'd love to say hello there too. If we can be praying for you, same drill, same number, but text the word prayer instead. And it will bring you to a prompt and you can put all your prayer requests in. And we got a team of elders here that will be praying alongside you all this week and even pray with you if that's something that you desire. So makes sense? Go ahead and text it in, and let me tell you about some things that are coming up on the horizon. Last Sunday, we announced table dinners, gatherings of people who are connected to Fellowship of Faith directly or by extension, getting together in geographic areas to eat, to do life together, to get together once a month to have a dinner together at a host's home. We've already had over 40 families sign up for this. We've got about 8 to 10 host families that are in the works, spreading from the range of up north, the borderlands of like the Hebron, Richmond kind of area, to Woodstock, to the Crystal Lake, Algonquin, Kerry Lake in the hills area, swinging around east, like the Volo kind of, Lake Moore kind of area, and all kinds of groups in McHenry as well. Don't let it pass you by. Tomorrow we are going to start more or less assigning people to the table dinners that they're going to be a part of. So make sure to register today if this is something that you want to be a part of. It's really simple. You go to fellowshipoffaith.org and right there on the homepage, you're going to see a button that says, "Get me more information." It will outline a little bit more what I just described to you with a big red button there that says, "Hey, sign me up." A little bit of information, 90 seconds in and out, and you are ready to go. Hosts will be in touch right after the 4th of July weekend. Secondly, Bible Bootcamp registration has opened today. Bible Bootcamp, all right, give it up for Bible Bootcamp, all right. Bible Bootcamp is our version of Vacation Bible School here at Fellowship of Faith for all kids, as long as they're potty trained up to fifth grade. And it's a week long of singing cadences and being put on a team and epic water fights and capture the flag battles and learning about Jesus and learning what it means to be someone in His service. It's a great event, and I actually think our leaders look forward to it more than our students, our sixth graders, our eighth graders, our high school kids, our college kids, and even our adults. So if you are in that demographic and would like to be a, quote, officer at Bible Bootcamp this year, hey, go to the same link, fellowshipoffaith.org. You can register right there, or you can contact our next gen director, Gwen Johnson, and she will help you with all the information you need. If you'd like to talk to anyone in person about any of this, just swing to the Welcome Center after the service today. One of our elders will be there to meet you. Gwen or some next gen staff will be around to meet you as well, and they can walk you through details if you have it. Here at FOF, we got 7 ways to give. If you'd like to give an offering today, go to fellowshipoffaith.org/giving, and you can read it right here on the screen in person, buckets in the back. You want to text to give, there's a number right there. If you're new with us today, though, please don't feel obligated or pressured. We're just glad that you're here. We're glad that you're checking it out, and you can just let all this kind of stuff just zone out and pass you by. Finally, the next 2 weeks, we will not have 9 o'clock ministries. We're doing our own version of a very mini summer break. So no rock or Boulder AM or adult class next Sunday or the Sunday after that at 9, but it all resumes again July 17th. Okay? Well, guys, I've been looking forward to this for a long time. We run a podcast called Questions You Never Thought You Could Ask in Church. Every Wednesday, there's a group of us who gather to field questions submitted in by you and people literally around the country and globe on God, on Christianity, on different belief systems, on spirituality, on life, you name it. And we field those trying to help people on their spiritual journey. Well, today we go live. Today we invite you to text your questions in. And for the next 30 minutes, I will get those anonymously and do the best job I can to answer them in real time right here on the spot. So let's roll the video and we'll jump on in. I feel like we need a studio audience, you know, and like the squares, and I'll take this question for 400, please, that kind of stuff. But here we go, because I believe that if we are in any way thinking about God or thinking about our lives below a mere surface level, if we are in any way contemplating and struggling with the issues we see in our world, are trying to be a follower of Christ today, we are going to have questions. Now, there are some people, and churches for that matter, that seem to take a certain posture and convey a certain attitude that asking questions about God is bad. They think that the questions revolving our struggles shouldn't be asked. The questions revolving around our doubts shouldn't be asked. Questions that we should already know the answers to shouldn't be asked. And my experience is people like that, both in and outside of the church, will often do a really good job of making us feel pretty stupid for asking them. They'll make us feel embarrassed or shamed or judged. But that is not what we believe here at Fellowship of Faith. There are 5 real core principles or values, if you will, that really define how we operate here at Fellowship of Faith, what we believe and how we do ministry. And I want to share one of them with you today. And here it is on the screen. It's a desire to be real. We believe the church needs to be a place where people can come and see that Christians are real people. It's experiencing joys, passions, and struggles. Because of this, we strive to communicate God's truth and share our experiences in open and honest ways. We believe it's important as a community to be honest about our shortcomings, authentic in our lives, and sincere in what we teach. We want to be humble as a church and express our faith in a way that is genuine. And I believe that. I believe that with all my core, and I believe that's what we need to be about here at Fellowship of Faith. And for that reason, we want to hear your questions, your struggles, your doubts. We want to hear about the things that are just getting you wondering about God with joy and the things that are scaring you as you consider it. We want to hear the silly questions and the serious ones. We want to hear the complex ones and the simple ones. We want to hear the orthodox questions and the heretical ones. We want you to ask the questions that you don't feel like Google is answering satisfactorily. We want you to ask the questions that you have struggled to ask before, that you have difficulty articulating. The questions that you don't really know where to turn, or questions for which the answers you have been given have been, shall we say, kind of just not hitting the mark. And we invite you to text those questions in to 815-314-0363. Again, it's 815-314-0363. See, I don't worry about people who have spiritual questions. I worry when people don't. Because what it indicates to me is one of a few things. One, perhaps that they think they just have it all figured out, which to me betrays, sadly, I think, in inner arrogance. Or two, that I know enough, that I've got enough, which says to me that you've stopped growing. That you're treating God more as a service provider than someone that you're in a relationship with. Or three, that you're just not taking the time to really give time in your life to think about God and consider Him and the importance of what He is doing in you and in this world. Or maybe even this, that something is holding you back. Fear. Embarrassment, a bad experience in the past when you've asked the question and have been treated in a similar way to what I described earlier, or something like that. It's a bit akin to me, to couples in a relationship, in a marriage. I don't worry about the couples that have conflict. I tend to worry more when they never do. Because it says to me that in that relationship, someone is afraid to express their opinion. Someone is afraid to have their own voice. Someone is checked out and just not willing to put the effort in that might lead to disagreement, or that even worse, someone might be afraid of the repercussions of what will happen. So we want you to text your questions in. And if that number wasn't big enough, here's it even bigger. 815-314-0363. I will get them anonymously. Yes, anonymously, unless you text your name in your text, right? I will get them anonymously right here on the spot. And I am just going to do the best job I can to answer them straightforwardly, honestly, candidly, humbly, from a position of what I believe God's word teaches, and hopefully in the process, we can help you navigate the questions that you're asking about God, about a relationship with Jesus, about other belief systems and religions, about how they compare, about how to be a Christian in this world, about how to do the spiritual life, about Fellowship of Faith, about me, about the staff, about anything in between. So let me fire this up. We're going to see where it's going to take us. And they are already flowing in. All right. Who is the hottest person you know at Fellowship of Faith? Fantastic. But he's married, ladies, so I hate to, you know, break your heart right here. You're a hot man, Kyle, all right? You're a hot man, though Mike McKay might have you on the keys here. I'm not sure. Maybe we can do a you know, hot or not kind of vote off on this. But, my vote is for this girl who just, like, I mean, it borders on sinful. She works up in, like, the tech booth, and she does, like, pregame and postgame shows. I mean, smoking, all right? So that's where my vote goes on that one. All right, as a Christian, is it okay to feel sad about infertility when everyone just tells you to trust God and anything can happen? Oh my gosh, I could just, like, feel the knife in the chest. Yes. Yes, it is okay to feel sad, to not be able to realize something like having a baby biologically of your own that you want. And it only, I think, makes it worse when well-meaning people come along and give a cliche line that anything is possible with God. Yes, anything is possible with God. Yes, pray to God. Yes, ask for it boldly. But trust God to it. And if God is not giving you that gift right now, trust yourself and entrust yourself into his hands and allow yourself to grieve in that. It is certainly okay. It is okay to be sad with God. Great question. Thanks for asking. How about this? Is it possible to believe in the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and still believe in other religions and their prophets, and I'm going to insert some words, that they are possible as a road to God? I've heard it put this way once. There are many roads to Christ, but only one road to God. There are many different ways God will work in this world, regardless of culture or language or belief system or religion, to help bring people to a clearer understanding of who he is. And Jesus himself in the Bible witnesses that Jesus is the clearest revelation of who God actually is. And God is unscrupulous. He will use any means at his disposal to try to bring people to see Christ. But Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father, or God, if I can put it that way, except by me. And so ultimately, there are many ways that God is operating, and many people operating sincerely with partial visions, partial truths, certain glimpses in different belief systems around the world and throughout history that have been instrumental by God to help people take steps. But ultimately, the way to God is fundamentally through Christ. So hopefully that gives some insight into navigating this question. It's a fantastic one. And talk about a great question just at the core of what we leave in an intertextual, intercontextual world as different societies and beliefs come crashing together today. Here's one. What do you think of the Baha'i faith? Interesting. You know, Baha'i has not really gotten a lot of attention, I found, in the 21st century, like we used to hear about it in the mid to late 20th century. There's a Baha'i temple, of course, on the North Shore. I don't know if it's in Wilmette or Highland Park or whatever, and beautiful architecture. Go check it out sometime. But I think it makes the fundamental mistake of treating all belief systems as equal, and therefore as equal expressions and ways of coming to God. The basic idea behind Baha'i is that every belief system out there, whether you call it Hindu or Muslim or Christian or your kind of own self-concocted variety of belief, if you will, are equal and adequate expressions and all kind of hinting or touching on the same thing. Well, there is certainly commonality between any belief system in this world who has taken God seriously. And you'll find commonalities across all belief systems in this world. But it makes light of the differences. And the differences are important. If I was to say something to you today, like, all women are basically the same. At one level, there's a certain common denominator of truth to that. Guys, as we well know, right? And yet, doesn't it sell so short? The uniqueness, the individuality, and the differences of what God made in this amazing creature called female. And to say that every female and what they believe is equally valid, we would say that's ridiculous. To say that every math answer is equally valid would be ridiculous. To say that every belief system and what they purport is true about God is not only ridiculous, it's insulting to every single belief system out there because it minimizes and dismisses what they actually believe dearly to be important and true. So that's the error that I think that Baha'i happens to make. Now, someone texted here to this number. Don't do that. That's a different number. All right? Here to this number won't work, so make sure to kind of fix that and don't text here. And by the way, please don't email me directly to this number. Some of you do that as well. I'm seeing some personal things come up. And pastor@fellowshipoffaith.org, this will not get answered, all right, outside of Sunday morning. So, now that that's said to one question, it has recently been said that you can be a Christian without believing in the words of the Bible. Your thoughts? Yeah, you can be a Christian without believing in the words of the Bible, but it's not the right way to practice Christianity. You can be on the football team without going to practice or working out. All right? You can be on the team, but you're kind of missing something, and you're missing something central and important to really getting at the core of what it is. Every Christian at some level is inconsistent in their faith, believing things that are not true, engaged in practices that are not God-honoring, or in other words, doing things and showing by their life and action and thought that they truly do put their faith in something other than the Bible. It's true for every single one of us, but what God does is he calls us back to the Bible, and he asks us that when our beliefs and ideas about reality and ourselves come into conflict with what he reveals in the Bible, that we should bend our knee to the Bible rather than trying to get the Bible to conform to what we want to be true or what we happen to believe. So yes, it is possible, but it is not good and what the journey with Christ ultimately leads to. The Bible is rich, and it's living, and it's active, and it invites us to take it as the very words being spoken by God's mouth himself. And I encourage, if you struggle with the Bible, wrestle with the Bible, or have never read the Bible, just start. Just get lost in it and begin the journey, even if difficult, of letting God speak to you. All right, here's some. When evil people die, are they judged right then and sent to hell? Or do they just cease to exist until judgment day? Let me kind of unpack how this works. And the way I would like to do it is by analogy. Central to the New Testament teaching, central to the message of Jesus, and central to Christian faith is that a day is going to come when Jesus is going to return. And I mean like physically, like you're going to see him, like the heaven's going to rip open, like he's going to come in glory, like angels are going to surround him, like trumpets are going to be blasting, like you're not going to miss it because you were watching TV. You know what I'm saying? And when he comes, he is going to judge all people, Christians and non-Christians, good and evil, living and dead. That is the judgment day all of us look forward to, right? Or wait. But the New Testament will often speak frequently that for those who are in Christ, a pre-judgment is given now. You can do a New Testament word study just on the word now, and it will unearth all kinds of fascinating ideas to you. And the best way I can put it is this, that we are in Christ, no matter how evil we happen to be, our sins are forgiven, and we have nothing to fear on Judgment Day. Because Christ has borne all of our evilness, and God will look at us and say, not just not guilty, but will look at us and actually say, righteous. Not because you're inherently good, but because God's saying, because of what my son Jesus has done for you. And for those of us who are in Christ, who call on his name, who put our faith in him, we're kind of out on parole, all right? We're still waiting for the final court date, but we've been given bail. We're out, we're free, and we can live in the freedom of the judgment that's coming now. Now, will the people who are not sharing in that cease to exist? No, no, by no means. And there is debate within Christian thought about how conscious of time people actually are who have died and awaiting judgment day. Some say it's just like you and me. You're just aware of the moment by moment by moment. Others say it's more like falling asleep. You kind of, and then you wake up and it's like, wow, like 8,000 years went by. That would be a good nap. There's merits to both of those arguments, but the way that I've liked, that's resonated with me, is imagine it like this. Imagine you fall asleep. Imagine you fall asleep and you have a dream. And if you're a believer, it will be the best dream you have ever had. If you're not in Christ, it'll be a nightmare. Now imagine Judgment Day coming and waking up and finding that dream become a reality. Hopefully that will help you steer some of the questions you're asking on that. Do you think, with all the chaos in the world, we are living in the early book of Revelations? Okay, the last book of the Bible is called Revelation, or in Catholic translations, the Apocalypse, if you will. It means the same thing, and it just means a revealing of something. I don't just believe that we are living in the early part of that book. I believe that we're living in the entire book. The Apostle Peter, in Acts chapter 2, when he stands up and starts explaining the events of Jesus' crucifixion, resurrection, ascension, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, describes it as a fulfillment of what Joel, the prophet Joel in chapter 2, calls the last days, which means we have been in the last days since like 30 AD, give or take. And I know what you're thinking. I don't know if God knows what he means when he uses the word last, you know? Because, like, how long do the last days go? Well, I don't know what to tell you. I don't know. But that's how the New Testament talks about it. And so what's written in the book of Revelation is not so much a sequence of events that's going to happen in the future. That's like, well, is it our generation? Or do we kind of, like, luck out on this one, you know, and beat it to the punch by, like, dying first? No. It's a very symbolic description of what everyone in the last days lives, and all people who have lived since 30 AD in what we can call the church age. It's a symbolic description of what all of us will face who are believers in Christ between the two comings of Christ, his first coming back then and his coming again. So yes, but maybe not quite in the same way that you're asking. Now, we got good heaven questions here today. And here's a triple text that came in. Is doubt bad? Follow-up, is doubt sinful? Let me take that one first. Is doubt bad? Can I rephrase it? It's reality. Just like fear is reality. And faith is not so much the absence of doubt, but choosing to trust God despite doubt. That's what faith isn't anything, isn't it? How many times have we been afraid to act? Do I ask her to marry me? Do I uproot the family and move? Do I go to this school or that school? Do I ask him out? All of us live with doubts in our heart and times of uncertainty, but what faith is daring to step out anyway and do it despite doubt. It's a lot like courage. Courage is not the absence of fear. No, courage is being terrified, but acting anyway. So, God does not invite us to doubt. He invites us to trust. But if you have doubt, can I just say it's okay? It's okay and as normal as can be. But dare to trust God despite your doubt and move more and more from places of doubt to trust. And through it, God will build more and more assurance and certainty. Is doubt sinful? Well, certainly it can be if we use it as an excuse to keep from acting. If we use it as a buffer to keep from stepping out towards God, if we always kind of bring it in so that we can kind of step back and almost methodically stand over it all and go, well, until my doubts are settled, I can't in integrity do this. Ah, BS. BS. Take a leap. Take a leap. God asks you to leap. And he says, trust me. You know how God says, trust me? I love it. Genesis chapter 12 comes to a guy named Abram. And he says, Abram, you're pretty cool. He doesn't actually say that. It's my translation. Abraham probably actually wasn't too cool. Abraham was probably one of the uncoolest people you'd ever meet. In fact, I'm regretting what I said earlier, because I think if you look at the storyline of Abraham, the reason God chose Abraham is precisely because he really wasn't cool and really wasn't that good, and there was nothing special about him, but God chose him anyway. And he says, Abram, I'm going to make you great. I'm going to make your name great, and you are going to be a blessing. I'm going to bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you, and all people will be blessed through you. Go to the land that I will show you, and there I am going to do it. And Abraham has to just get up and go. Now, I would want, like, GPS. I would want an itinerary. I would meet with my family for 9 months. We would do a cost analysis, right? Leap. Leap, he says. And not blindly. But because I've proven myself trustworthy, God says. Because I've shown myself to be faithful, God says. Dare to trust me now in these areas where you're afraid. Move out of doubt and into faith. There we go. Now, some follow-ups. Do you think there's a staircase up to heaven? No, but immediately you're going to come and like throw like a Genesis 28 to 32 in my face where Jacob falls asleep and he sees a staircase going up to heaven. I don't know if that was kind of like a temporary gig, like, you know, beam me up, Scotty, and it just kind of shot down for the moment, or if it's like always there and it's like, where's the stairs, you know? But those are stairs I don't want to climb. Well, I do, but you know what I mean. And finally, do you think heaven is under us or in the sky? Let me do something to help you reframe the way you think about heaven. I think we think of heaven like a great piece of real estate. Like God got a good agent and stumbled across a great deal somewhere before it went on the market and went, oh my gosh, look at the view of the lake. You know what I mean? And like, that's where we go. Now, I know that's a little crazy, but don't we kind of think of heaven as a place? What if heaven instead is more akin to a state of existence? What if heaven is more transdimensional? What if heaven is literally right here in front of my face, but I'm too dense to see? And what if heaven is better expressed by being in the presence of God in a fuller, more complete way where there is a clearer vision of who he is, and shall I say, in the radiation blast of all the goodness that comes off of him? Because what makes heaven heaven is God. Heaven is where God is at in his most full, complete, and glorious state. And it might be right before our eyes. and the existence of heaven we have might not mean traveling to some galaxy long, long ago and far, far away, but instead a shift, a translation, a changing, if you will, into all things different. Chew on that one, and you can ask back. All right. All right, here. Open up. If space aliens are real, I love this, how does that reconcile with the Bible? I am tempted this morning, I'm not going to, but I'm tempted this morning to ask who believes in extraterrestrial life and who doesn't. And by the way, whoever asked, I am so grateful that you said space aliens, because I was going to so be a jerk about it and talk about how Deuteronomy talks about like the alien and the orphan and the widow and how we're supposed to welcome them in as like, you know, immigrants and people who are displaced from their homes. But the Bible does not specifically talk about, well, let me qualify. I was going to say that the Bible does not specifically talk about extraterrestrial life, but the Bible actually does specifically talk about extraterrestrial life. It talks about sentient beings that exist who don't find Earth as their home, and you've heard of them. They're called angels. They're called demons. They are called sons of God, to use the biblical language. Now, we know that that exists. And when it says that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, what it signifies is that God just didn't just create earth itself, but created the universe. And it is quite possible and feasible and arguable to say that God made a wonderful array and a diverse variety of life that maybe we have not met in other planets, galaxies, multiverses, or however we discover it to form. How does it reconcile with the Bible? Just fine, thank you very much. It really does. To insist that it exists, I think, is going too far. I don't mean angels and demons and that, but I mean, you know, what you kind of think like E.T. phone home, right? Or worse. But, wow, I dated myself there. That was like total like 1982 coming out my pores, right? Sorry, 48. But at the same time, Colossians, Ephesians, Corinthians, which I think will be new, what I would call platform books as we come into the centuries to come and discover more and more about the universe, are very clear that Christ is seated not just above planet Earth, but Christ is seated above the cosmos. That all things have their being through him, that all things are under his authority, that he is the savior not just of human beings, but of the cosmos. That when Jesus died on the cross, it wasn't just to redeem you Homo sapiens. It was to redeem all life, all of God's creation, the sentient and the non-sentient, the living and the rocks and dirt and weather patterns too. Read those books for yourself. He's come to redeem it all. And if the mothership should come by the time that we leave service today, it's like, rock on. Do you know Jesus? And it would be a fascinating conversation there on out. Okay. Does God have legs? Feet? No. With the major faiths, Christians, Islam, and Judaism, so the major monotheistic faiths, let's say, is God the same? Go back to the question that came in earlier. I think the answer I gave there will help. Certainly, Islam and Judaism are touching closer on the truth of who God is as revealed in Christ than maybe other belief systems that are out there. But I encourage you not to think about it as binary, black and white, right and wrong, but degrees of truth and degrees of error. There are many things that are said in both Islam and Judaism that we as Christians would profess the same. Christianity itself is a Judaic religion. And yet, very fascinatingly, Jesus and the Apostle Paul will make the case that by rejecting Jesus, the Jews, who should have known him better than anyone, are fundamentally rejecting Christ, or rather God himself. And so the way I like to think about it is this. Imagine that you got into like a you got mail relationship with someone. And imagine that someone is God. And you're just kind of like texting back and forth. Or, you know, it's like an online thing and there's no profile picture there. And we know that we can't really trust profiles completely as they're posted, right? And you're getting into this online relationship. And you're going back and forth and you're learning stuff about them and you're getting stuff about them, but you've never seen them face to face. You've never learned who they are in the flesh. And then when you finally meet, you don't actually believe that that's who it is, right? It literally is the plot to You Got Mail. You don't believe who it actually is, and you reject the living embodiment and trade it for the image that you've created instead around the shards of truth that you have. Well, we can see how the shards of truth are certainly truth, but to reject the living embodiment is then to reject the actuality of who it is it said. And I think that works as a description of how we wrestle through the convergence of the monotheistic faiths. Ask more if that needs more elaboration. But I got like 8 billion questions here, which is quite fantastic. And this one's fascinating. Is Kanye West God? You decide, all right? Are all of the laws in Leviticus God-breathed? like 30 seconds of Leviticus is like, really, God, of all the things you could said, this is what you're leaving me with? Right? Who here has ever tried, I'm not going to say has read Leviticus, who has ever tried to read Leviticus? Would you own that here this morning? All right, who here has ever regretted that decision? You know, when people think about the weird laws of ancient past in the Bible, if you're a betting person, put money that it's coming from Leviticus. All right, there's some very strange things in there. And yes, they are absolutely all God-breathed. But just because they're God-breathed does not mean that they're applicable to you. Would you agree that I could say something to my daughter and I could say something to my mother? And what I might say to my daughter might not be applicable to what I say to my mother, and what I say to my mother might not be applicable to what I say to my daughter, even though both statements that I've made are true and out of my mouth? Would you agree with that? The Bible kind of works the same way. A lot of what we read in those Old Testament laws is spoken to Israel back then for a variety of reasons I won't get into right now. And while there is goodness and truth to be mined and distilled out of that, much of what he spoke to them, he spoke to them, not as a direct command for you to follow today. So please don't leave today and sacrifice a goat. Please don't distance yourself from the unclean. And it arguably is okay to get tattoos. Is it okay to ask God for signs? Oh man, which of us haven't? Which of us wouldn't just love God? Like just, Lord, just like, I'm struggling, man. Just like, explode some fire on the stage here or something. Or, you know, and not when Andrew's around, so we know he's doing like pyrotechnics or something like that, but which of us hasn't asked for that? You know, it is okay to ask God for signs. It really is. God wants you to ask him for whatever you sincerely want. But he then invites you to trust him with what you want according to what he knows is best for you. As the prophet Garth Brooks once said, thank God for unanswered prayers. There are times in the Bible when God, even through the prophets, like Isaiah in chapter 7 goes, demand a sign of me to a king in doubt. Demand a sign of me. Anything in the heavens above or on the earth below, demand a sign. And you know what King Ahaz does? Oh, I will not put the Lord my God to the test. I'll get over it. God was inviting him to. He didn't want to see what God could show him because then maybe he would have to change. Oh, be careful if you ask, all right? But at the same time, God will often invite us to trust him on signs already done. And do you know that's much of what the Bible is? a record of God giving sign after sign after sign after sign and saying, I literally rose from the dead. How many signs do I have to give you? Because at some point, signs are not enough. Signs can be helpful. Signs can be used as a tool by God. But at some point, he will always call you to the step of faith, regardless of what the signs may or may not be indicating. Yeah. All right, let me do a couple more, and then we'll land the plane here for today. I think this is a follow-up to the hands and feet one. Nope, different question, but from someone else. Does God have human features? Well, Jesus certainly has human features because Jesus was made human, and so Jesus being fully of God, you can make a circuitous argument to say yes. But no, you know, many times in the Bible, God will be referred to with what are called anthropomorphisms. How do you like that $10 word here today? With anthro, like anthropology, human, morphisms, like Mighty Morphin Power Rangers, forms, right? Anthropomorphisms, or, yeah. The hand of God, the arm of God, the eye of God. These are ways that the prophets write by analogy to help us to understand what God does, not to indicate that God is like 6'3", has brown hair, can bench 220. You know, I mean, stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? That's not what it's doing. God is spirit. And so it would seem to be that when we are made in God's image, it's not kind of like, well, okay, you know, God has a hand, so here's a hand, but something deeper and more transcendent than that. And let me land the plane for time's sake with this one today. Is it okay to love someone who does not believe in God? Oh, you bet. Thank you for asking. Thank you for asking. You bet it is not only okay to love someone who does not believe in God. God wants you to love people who do not believe in him. And more than that, God wants you to love people who hate him, who despise him, who blaspheme him, who undercut him, who trample on him. Much of Jesus' ministry was going to people who rejected God in thought, word, or deed. Jesus loved sinners. God loves people. All people. From the people who believe in him with the uttermost devotion, to the people who reject him with the uttermost hate, to the people who are just cold and apathetic and the uttermost way, God loves these kinds of people. And if you're one of these kinds of people, God loves you. God loves you so much even if you don't love him. God loves you even if you don't believe in him. God loves you even if you've trounced his name. God loves you even if you're going off to some convention right after this today to try to undermine belief in God in this world today. God loves you. And the way of Christians is meant to fundamentally be defined by love. Fundamentally, God loves. And so a follower of God is fundamentally called to love as well, no matter who it is. You remember what Jesus says? You have heard that it's said, love your neighbor, but hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemy and pray for those who persecute him. Love them like they've never been loved before. And through that love, maybe a better understanding of who God is and the relationship God wants to have with them can be glimpsed, even if just a little, through you. That's all the questions for today. And not because there aren't more. Oh my gosh, guys, rock on. I mean, I'm like still scrolling. There are so many questions that came flooding the stage today. Good questions that we want to answer. And here's the good news for you. Next Sunday, we are doing the exact same thing. We are inviting you to bring your phone again. We are inviting you to bring in the questions you have that haven't been answered. And we are going to get to some of these next week, but we are also going to take the new questions coming. So invite someone who's asking questions. Invite someone who you think needs a place that they can ask questions. But we're going to do this as well. We run a podcast called Questions You Never Thought You Can Ask in Church every Wednesday at 12:30 p.m. Central. We will get to every single one of the questions you ask in time. Now, not this Wednesday. There's too many. But we'll begin. And you can catch that on our webpage, fellowshipoffaith.org. Go to the FOF Plus page, and you'll find a link to the podcast right there. Or hop on Spotify, or Apple, or whatever podcast provider you use, and just search Questions You Never Thought You Could Ask in Church. And you'll get it there. Or join us live on Facebook through Fellowship of Faith's Facebook page. And you'll get it there and can even post questions in the comment. We want to help you with your questions. So let's keep the conversation going. Way to go on that today, guys. Way to go on the questions you're asking, the way God is turning in your heart. I'm going to invite band to come back up. I'm going to invite you to stand with me. And let's just kind of come to God in prayer, all right? Let's come to God in prayer. Let's come to God in worship. Let's come to God in faith. And what I want to use today is a prayer that we've been using here for some time that comes out of Acts chapter 2. It comes at the very end. There you go, Lexi. Now we're all good. It comes at the very end and describes how these believers in Christ oriented their lives and lived in relation to what God was doing in them. Let it speak to you. Let it convict you. Let it encourage you. Let it draw you into deeper faith. Let it create a vision for you of what God is dreaming in your life with Him. Lord, devote us to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Fill us with awe at the wonders and miraculous signs done by the apostles. Bring us together in common. May we sell our possessions and goods to help those in need. We will continue to meet, breaking bread in our homes and eating together with glad and sincere hearts. Receive our praise, O God. May we enjoy the favor of all the people. Add to our number daily those who are being saved. Amen. how do you follow that song? I mean, just the image of Christ on that cross in his death, defeating the forces of hell and inviting all people into a new kingdom in his name, where no matter what is against you cannot stand and will flee by the name of Jesus. Where do you go from that except with worship and praise and thanks to God for what he has done for you and for me and the cosmos in which we live? And may the living God bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and radiate upon you. May the goodness and strength and power of God and the presence of his Spirit fill your life, convict your heart, encourage your soul, and guide you into deeper, deeper life with him. Thank you for coming today. Go in Jesus' name.
So where do you go from there with that song? I don't know. We're going to do a new song. How about that? But before we do that, can I just have you, everybody, turn around and take a look at the booth right now. It's Tony's birthday. Happy birthday, buddy. I bought him a little pink crown, but for some reason he doesn't have it on. There it is. Wear it proudly, Tony. All right, here we go. Ready?
Up and patch me up, you do every time. I'm getting near.
Welcome back, everybody.
Welcome back, guys.
That's a great new song. I love it.
So the church I went to last week, they sang this there, and I'm like, I don't remember Steve's voice hearing this song, because I know this song.
Right.
And so it's a new song, so I didn't know Steve's voice.
That's awesome. It's very good.
I like that song.
It's got a country vibe to it, and I'm a country fan, so it resonates with me more.
My youngest daughter doesn't like country music. It breaks my heart.
That's okay. She'll warm up.
I pray for her daily.
Everyone says they don't like country music, then they start listening to country music, and then they start to like it. Let's give it time.
I created a playlist on Spotify called Good Country Music that I'm going to share with her.
Yeah.
She went into my account and changed the name to Good Country Music, in parentheses, it doesn't exist. That's the name of my playlist.
Dang, that's
now.
Harsh. That's harsh.
So if you have good country music songs, text them to me,
okay.
And I will add it to my list.
All right. Will do. That is a tad bright.
Is it too much?
Yeah, I think so. It's even worse. No, it's not enough. Yeah. Okay, it's better, I think. What do you think?
Now you can see our smiling faces. Now I can't see anybody.
Yeah, it's like a flashbang.
Yeah.
So, really good questions today. Like, deep questions.
You know, we've been doing
questions.
For several years now. And so I'm always a little bit afraid that the well is going to dry up.
Right.
You know, people aren't really going to ask a lot of questions. And
not quite.
It sounds really cool.
No, they keep coming. And
proud of you guys.
Yeah.
Woo!
Keep them coming. Like, we love it. I mean, it kind of makes us think about things a little bit more. Mm-hmm. Phrasing questions we never thought about makes us question things a little bit more in a good way. Like, trying to get better understanding.
Yeah.
That alien question, that's a good one.
Okay, that was somebody. I don't know who texted that
but
in.
But definitely knew.
Definitely knew Dave's personality, because if they would have just said aliens, he'd be like, that.
He's done that in the past.
There was one question, and I don't know if it went through fast, that Dave answered no. And moved on to the next one.
Yeah, like, does God have hands or feet?
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
He does not, so apparently.
Jesus does.
Yes, but does God? Mm. No. Short and sweet. But yeah, they're very good.
And I also need to state, it was not my question that asked who's the hottest person that Dave knows. That was not me.
I wonder who it was. Sometimes the questions like that makes me wonder.
What else? What else? What other questions? Oh, Abraham. Dave is still right.
Yeah.
If God says go, then we'd be like, we need to some research and do some planning.
And this economy, I don't know. That makes sense. Yeah, but I mean, just think about the disciples, too. Jesus called to them to follow me, and they just dropped everything they did, were doing and followed him. I mean, I don't know if I could do that.
Well,
I don't know.
I heard it described like this. All right.
What you got?
So the, what are they called? The teachers of the law were kind of like rock stars at the time.
Oh, yeah.
And so they were kind of famous. And so if you grew up following them, like you knew them. And so it'd be like saying that you're a good basketball player, and Michael Jordan comes to you and says, hey, come with me, I'll train you. Wouldn't you drop everything?
Yeah,
and
that's,
like, I'll co-train with
true.
Michael Jordan.
Very
and
true.
I know that is a dated reference.
No, it's still very, very much relevant.
Not, okay.
Very much relevant. That's a good point. I mean, I didn't think of it like that.
Yeah.
You know, if someone from a profession or something that I consider myself
so
good.
Stupid movies are like, the apostles are zombies. The disciples are zombies. I'll follow you. No. They're real people.
They have more courage than whoever called them zombies. That's for sure. that's a good way to put it.
So Wednesday, it's going to be more questions you never thought you could ask on 216thNet.
And Facebook Live from 12:30 to 1:30. Mm-hmm. You can also find it on a slew of other devices or apps. I didn't even realize Apple Podcasts has that up, so I can listen to it while I work.
So a few weeks ago, I was talking about it, and I said that I think Steve's sole purpose is to be a disruptor.
Yeah.
And I really hope I didn't hurt your feelings, because I meant that completely lovingly.
He did say something about that.
About
he's like,
it.
I got to get her back now.
I don't like.
That's funny. But, I mean, maybe that is the... I like that some of these questions are very deep and they're heavy, right? And I like that Dave includes some lighthearted, funny questions to kind of break it up a little bit and dive right back in.
I got to tell you, today I was surprised at the questions that there wasn't more. Like, our world kind of seems like it's going crazy.
Yeah, really.
And there wasn't any questions about the Supreme Court or about sexuality or about anything like that.
I'm sure that's maybe he's saying that to him.
Is that people that are afraid to ask those questions because they're afraid of what answer they expect to hear?
That's good. It's not necessarily I'm afraid that someone's going to know I asked the question. It's more of I don't know what I want to hear. What is the answer something I want to hear?
Yeah.
But
there's a lady that's been coming here for quite a while. She's actually on staff now. And I know there was a time where we're like, hey, you're not a member. We don't really care, but do you want to take like the membership classes? And she actually said, I don't want to because I'm afraid that I'm going to hear something that I'm going to disagree with and then we can no longer come here.
Interesting.
To which Dave said, why do you have to leave if you disagree with something? I mean, fundamental. I mean, but if it's like...
I don't agree with what you said, but that's...
I don't agree with your take on this.
God made us all unique, right? So there's a reason why we think this way, and that's a good thing.
Yeah.
And differing opinions are always a good thing.
So that's to say, if you guys have questions about things that you're afraid to hear the answer, okay, well, let's start a conversation.
And maybe that answer that you're afraid to hear will make you think of things in a new light and maybe give you a new perspective.
Or,
maybe that's what God wants.
Make us think of things in a different
Very
light.
True.
I mean, this is not a one-sided conversation.
No. And the goal isn't to make you change your mind at all. This is just
goal
Dave's...
Goal is holiness.
You're right, exactly.
And whatever that means. I mean, everybody needs holiness.
If you don't agree...
I heard a thing that said, God's goal is not forgiveness. It's holiness. Forgiveness is just a step of the way.
Yeah, a step.
Okay. I
love that. That is a really good one. I like that, too.
Yeah.
And no, it's not like if you don't agree with what an answer that Dave gives, it's not... He's not trying to say, oh, you're wrong. This is just...
I will say, so Dave and I will be married 26 years this summer.
How exciting.
Dave is not always right.
Despite what he likes to think.
And he might be right most of the time.
And this is,
but he's not always.
He always prefaces these type of series like he says, I'm going to answer them to the best of my ability.
Yeah.
We do not have all the answers by any means. Great. I wish we did. That'd be great.
That'd be boring.
It would be boring,
so boring.
But it'd be less stressful, I feel like, if we had all the answers. But Dave tries his best. And
all right, what do we have going on this week? Softball
tomorrow.
What time?
I think they won their doubleheader this past Monday. Both games. So congratulations to our softball team.
It was at home on Monday.
Yeah, I did not go.
I took Ben to his college orientation.
How was that? Was it fun?
It was fun. Because I went to Valpo for a couple years, so it was cool being on campus again.
Yeah, yeah.
But, so they split up the boys, or the kids and the parents. They split them up. And so at the end, we kind of all get together. And I'm like, so, did you meet any cute girls? Like mom does. And he's like, Mom, I'm not coming home with a girl. Stop thinking about it. I'm coming here to study. I'm like,
so down to business.
When he comes home with the girl, it will be the girl. And I'm super excited about it.
Well, that's exciting to think.
And girl, if you're listening, I'm already praying for you. I don't know your name yet.
There's a song by a country artist, Matt Stell, I want to say. It says, I prayed for you. And he's talking about his future wife. And I've been praying for you. It's a really good song. Look it up. It's very fantastic.
I will.
Talking about country
and
music.
Then Garth Brooks,
the prophet Garth Brooks. That's
a
great
Ben's
song.
Come back to my I've been praying for your wife. That's gonna be his comeback.
I hope it is. That's creative. How was did they have a luncheon at the cafeteria or whatever
their
your
food
meal hall
was really good?
So don't expect that. Tell Ben not to expect that. They pull out all the stops for those orientations.
That's
I'm telling
true.
You from experience, it goes way downhill after
Valpo
that.
Valpo has always had really good food.
Oh, that's good.
Even from 20 years ago.
Good. That's good.
Oh my gosh, 20 years? No. 30.
He kept thinking about it and it got worse.
So at this wedding we were at yesterday, Dave realized, he pointed out to me, that Dave and I are now the age of our aunts and uncles when we got married. And when we got married, they seemed so old. And now we're the old.
Oh, no. That revelation.
Right? It just doesn't stop.
No, it does not.
It just keeps on moving forward.
That's something I learned very early. The world does not stop revolving no matter where you are in life. It still continues
moving.
All right,
so back on track.
Yep. Pull it back.
Back on track. Monday is softball.
Wednesday is never questions you never thought you can ask in church. The podcast, 12:30 to 1:30 on Facebook
Live.
And
then next Sunday is more questions.
Remember, no Wednesday night ministries for the summer. I think we pick back up in August at some point, I think.
Sure.
If I'm wrong, you can yell
at
me.
We'll let you know in August.
Yeah, we'll let you know.
All right, we're going to hit it.
Yeah. Enjoy the beautiful weather outside because it's really nice out.
Really good to be back with you guys.
For those of you in the area. Yeah, it's all great. As always, to be here.
All right. Have a good week, guys.
Take care.